My name is Daniel Kreuter, and I want to talk today about using machine learning methods to predict virtual sensor response on a test bench. I think machine learning, or more specified, neural network, very famous and now published in a wide domain of technologies. For example, we are using this for Google Translate. We are using it to understand and recognize different visions, using for automated driving and so on. But there are also possibilities to use these methods in our technical domain. That means in requirement engineering, in durability, and also in our case, in the load derivation of acceleration signals. And I want to show you this as an example, how we integrate such novel methods in our existing tool chain, which requirements we have for that, maybe also which challenges we have, and give you a short overview of the methods we have developed so far. I'm working for Bosch. For the Bosch Research Department, located in the Stuttgart area. We are a lot of engineers, scientific staff, and so on. You can see here this slide with some highlights of it. And we are working right now together with the so-called Bosch Center for Artificial Intelligence in all areas which handle deep learning networks, machine learning intelligence, and so on. But come to our presentation for today. I will start with a short motivation to show why it's necessary or worth to have a deeper look on such a method. Then I will proceed with the prediction itself. That means we have a look on acceleration time series. Starting with first with the pre-processing of this data. That means we have a look at the signals of the frequency contains on domains of the signals. We have to filter it. We have to make running statistics on it, and so on. Then I want to give you a short introduction in our approach we are using with artificial neural networks. That means I want to show you also some tools we have used for that. And in the end of this time series prediction, I want to say something about the estimation of the software and model quality of it. That means we cover also the uncertainty which comes up always with machine learning approaches, and I want to quantify it. In the end, I will sum up and give a short outlook what we plan in the next steps in this kind of technology. Okay, let's start with the load derivation itself. Normally, I think some of you know this called V of reliability, coming from our house of reliability we are using. So we have on the left side the load derivation based on a system, and we break the system load down to a stress on a single design element. And you can see it maybe right here. In our case, we have any vehicle as a system, and we like to break it down from an electrical power unit to an electrical control unit up to any design element on this electrical control unit, which could be a capacitor or a resistor or anything like that. We can use for that different simulation tools, for example, to derive the load from system to the component. We can use multi-body simulation tools, and then we can use finite element tools. And if you want to calculate the damage or the failure probability of some design elements or failure modes, we can use ENCODE or different other software. On the other hand, we have also some experimental effort to calculate the same steps on the experimental side. That means we're coming from some road load data acquisitions, maybe based on an OEM, or we have some norms or internal regulations, break it down to a component test on a 1D shaker. And if we want to test it on a design element level, we have to go more in detail. And you can see here on the right side, we have a shaker with a lot of, in the end, with 10 degree of freedom, where we can shake and load this electrical control unit with acceleration signals and can, let's say, reply the vehicle measurement on this test condition. And what I want to show to you is to replace the effort to run this experiment, why I will explain later on, with a neural network approach. Why we do not use the simulation side, because this all also takes a lot of effort to calculate nonlinearities we have in the system, to create parameters coming up with the calculation side. And it's a long time or a hard work to create simulations which fits the experimental results. Okay, and there are some buzzwords coming up. If we try to replace such experiments with machine learning, because it's totally new for a lot of people, so maybe there's not so much confidence in this process. There are also questions, how linear are our systems? Why should we use neural networks if it's linear or it's not? How big is the training effort on the pre and post processing of it? Is it worth to investigate in such kind of way to analyze loads? Do we have time reduction and so on? And I try to answer some of this question in this slide and will focus on it, how you can see later on. But maybe some words to the component we have under duty here. So you can see an engineering control unit on a piezo shaker, which is built up in a partner company of us. And we have in the end 10 different inputs. You can see here the golden one, the small one here. And we have different output signals. We will focus only on the acceleration sensor you can see here. And in the end, we have a signal system which can describe mathematically with a transfer function and a time series input vector and an output vector here. And we have to run a lot of tests, around 100 maneuvers we have to run on the experimental side. It takes a lot of time. It takes not only a lot of time to run this one, but also to set up the experimental tests, to check the experimental tests if they are working similar as we have done for the LDA and so on. And we want to reduce costs and time in this experimental effort by replacing a lot of these maneuvers running on a test bench. So maybe if you summarize our motivation, the first thing is we want to reduce this test bench time and the experimental effort. And also we want to indicate the most relevant or let's say damage critical maneuvers. And then in the after we have to indicate these maneuvers using machine learning approaches, we can run only these tests, for example, on a test bench. Or we can take a deeper look on it, on the data, on the time series, and decide then, do we want to run it on a test bench? Can we trust our results on based on the machine learning approach and so on? Okay, first of all, In our point of view, it makes only sense to use machine learning approaches here if we can check or if we have a nonlinear system on it. And first thing is to check it. We check it very easily with different methods. One method could be Laplace transformation into Schick and the Laplace domain, the different signals from different maneuvers. We can using called RMAX method, or maybe the most known method, it's called the transfer function estimation method. There are functions implemented directly in MATLAB, but also in Python. And here we have a very easy check to do so. So we trained in, or we calculated a transfer function based of one maneuver or track and tested this transfer function on a different track. We can see here the results in the time and the frequency domain, and we see that does not fit. Now, also from our experience with electric control units, we have here a very high dependency on temperature. We have nonlinearities based on the technology, how the energy control unit is mounted and so on. And we know that we have some degree of nonlinearity we cannot cover with, let's say, traditional easy simulation methods. And therefore we come up with this idea to replace the effort and the simulation, which is not possible right now here, with a neural network. Maybe some words about the neural network. So here it's a very easy, or let's say the basic one. It's called a feed forward network. And a neural network is always based on three layers. The first layer is the input layer. And the last layer you can see here is the output layer. And in the middle we have up to or at least one hidden layer, but we can have as many hidden layers we want. If we have a lot of hidden layers, we are talking about deep learning networks, but yeah, there's no defined number of hidden layers to say now we have one and now we do not have one. And we feed our network here into the input layer with our information data, train this based on our output, that's our labels we have from known results, and with that we can train our parameters of every neuron you can see here. And if you have a deeper look on the neuron, it's not, or it's, I think it's not so sophisticated mathematical formulation. There's only a weight function you can see here, which comes in. Oh, let's start here on this point. We have some input information from all layers before. That means we got here three input information, and for all of the input information, we weight the input information at bias and sum up all input information. The weight function could be different. There are some sigmoid functions, for example. You can see here a thing. You have this ReLU function, you can see here. But there are a lot of different functions which fits also different problems. And if you sum up the information from this input cell, and this information is higher than a defined level, we will send out a new output from this cell to the next layer, or to every neuron of the next layer. And the training is only to, or with the training, we can calculate the unknown parameter of this existing system, and the training parameters are or the parameters we want to train are the weight functions and the bias of every neuron. That's a network, let's say a standard or basic network when we feed forward. But in time series, or in we do not use in general feed forward networks. We are using so-called RNN networks, recurrent neural networks, where we can store information a little bit longer. That means this, or let's start with this point. This train network was invented in the 19th by Hochreiter and Stucker, and they started for text learning, for example. That means we have to check, or we have to consider the beginning of a sentence if we want to understand the end of the sentence. And we have also, and that's very similar to a time series, because in a time series depends what happened some, let's say, time steps before. And that's very important for the time, for the next time step of it. And therefore, we are using so-called long short-term memories. And they have some more sophisticated structure you can see here. That means we have also an input gate, but we have also a forget gate, and we get an output gate of it. And the big advance of it in comparison to this classical or standard neurons I have shown the slide before is that we can track our long-term dependencies in the input sequences. That means a mathematical point of view, our calculation of the bias and the weight factors are more sensitive for every layer. And our idea, and if we have just one network with one single neuron, we could, that's mathematical identically, we could describe a 1 degree Dirac symbol signal. And our idea, what I want to show you right now, it's if we have a multi-degree of freedom system, we create a network with enough neurons and enough layers to estimate a multi-input, multi-output system with a lot of, or describing with a lot of Dirac inputs. So let's start with a preparation of the time series data to feed them into this network. And for the training, we selected randomly some maneuvers or tracks coming from the test band, from the test bench, from previous measurements, or from LDA, so on. We resampled the data. We applied a bandpass filter on it, and we remove all parts of the time series which give us no information. That means all zero values. So mostly in maneuvers, you have in the end and in the beginning just noise or zero noise values. And this parameter doesn't have any information for the network. And we removed this with some running statistics, which are available at ENCODE, for example, but also available at PyLife. That's the library available at GitHub. That means it's an open source library Bosch has developed in the last recent years, and have some more techniques around lifetime estimation, reliability, durability, material parameter estimation, which are not included in commercial software yet. Okay, if we have our pre-processing done, we are ready with our input creation, And then we can feed our network. That means we have here, in our case, 10 input sensors. And you can call it also features. And in this single example, to show how this procedure works, we just selected one acceleration sensor on the electrical control unit as the output sensor. That means we have one label only. Then we say we want to define a discretized time signal. You can see here with a defined time range to consider to predict the signal of our label. Yeah? And we have to stack our time series into a 3D array. You can see here. That means we have here still our 10 signals. And we have, for every of these 10 signals, we split this whole signal in different time steps. And for every time step, every single measured parameter here is our input into a neural network. That means we have a really big neural network. We have a lot of input data, and we have or we have to train it with a time which is big enough to train all of the parameters. And so here, for example, the first layer or first stack give us the result of this time. The second one is give us the result or the prediction of the acceleration of the next time step, and so on. We are using for pre-processing and all of that Python classical libraries and also PyLab. For the creation of the neural network, we are using TensorFlow, and as a backend and as an RPM, we are using Keras to set it up. And both of it are available at Python and are state of the art for not only for recurrent neural networks, but also for traditional neural networks. Here you can see the structure of the neural network. So in the end, we have 130,000 or around 130,000 parameters we have to train. And the structure looks like this one. We are starting with the input layer. Then we have three different long short-term memory layers. We have a dropout layer, and in the end, we converge all these layers to calculate the output layer. You can, with TensorFlow, you can create also so-called tensor boards to see how is your train and validation loss. You can have a look on this one here, or you can have also a look on the structure of the neural network here. As a result, we can predict the time series. You can see here, here we are comprised the true time series. You can see in green, and the predicted time series in purple, maybe. Huh? The time series, you can see also the comparison in the frequency range. You can see it in the cross plot, and you can see also some statistics of the time series, like the min max, the root mean square, and so on. Please consider that in the frequency domain, we just trained between 100 and 5,000 hertz as a network, and before this frequency range and after this one, we do not train. And you can see also in the result, if you do not have trained this network, the results are in the range we trained, the results are very good and fit very good. Before and after that range, the results are not trained and really bad. Until now, we just compared one test with one predicted result, or one experiment result with one predicted result. But we don't have any information about the confidence of the predicted result, because we have only checked one with one. Right? And now I want to have a deeper look on one track, which we have replicated 5 times on the Shaker test bench, and want to compare this one with our results from the neural network. If we have a look here, we can see that we cannot do this in the time domain, but if we have a look on the frequency domain, you can see here the power spectral density of this time signal, and also on some parameters describing the PSD, the power spectral density, we can say, yeah, it could be the same track, but we perform this 5 times here. And with help of that, we can calculate also a confidence level based on these tracks from the test bench, and can compare this track for the calculation of the confidence. We are using this so-called student t distribution because we have a very small sample size and we do not have any information about the standard deviation. I think that there are also other possibilities like Gaussian processes maybe, but we are using here the sample of the student t distribution to describe the confidence. And if we compare now the results from the measurement on the left side with the results from the prediction based on the neural network, we can see that almost most time, maybe here one track prediction lays in this confidence interval of 95%. Okay, so if I summarize this, right now we can reduce, of course, the test effort of my point of view. We can indicate all maneuvers. We can predict the maneuvers in 95% confidence interval. And we can, after we have predicted these parameters, if we calculate and make a damage calculation based on the predicted PSDs, for example, we can indicate the most critical maneuvers. And the idea is then to say, okay, we have indicated the most critical maneuvers. We just run this one on the test bench to make a double check how critical they are and how good are the results from the test bench and the predicted results based on the artificial neural networks. And for that we are using long short-term memories and using the method, structure and infrastructure of TensorFlow and Keras. It's all available in Python. It's open source and state of the art right now. But for us, it's much more important, and that's the outlook, and maybe more difficult to approach this, is to replace complete tests. Yeah? But what we have done so far, we still need some tests to generate training data. And after we have trained, let's say, or we have performed 3 maneuvers, we can create the training set, and we can predict all other maneuvers and then indicate the critical one. But what we want to do is replace the whole test. And that means we need a generalization of this neural network. That means we need a lot of different component designs we have trained, or we have to understand more physical the behavior of this component, in our case, the ECU. Maybe one possible result could be that we are using a so-called hybrid approach, where we're combining physical simulation, maybe finite element simulation or a multi-body simulation, together with machine learning approaches to calculate this nonlinear transfer functions based on first physical simulation. And one possible approach is to say, okay, we now that we get some error with the physical simulation, and we just want to reduce this error with help of our trained network.